Welcome, fellow LaunchBoxers. This is RetroPython with another LaunchBox tutorial. Today, our time machine takes us back to the 1980s, an era where keyboards clicked and a revolutionary device named the Commodore 64 was king. The Commodore 64, affectionately known as the C64, wasn't just a computer. It was embodiment of the digital revolution. With its groundbreaking 8-bit MOS technology 6510 microprocessor and 64 kilobytes of RAM, it wasn't just a machine. It was a universe. A universe where games like Impossible Mission and Maniac Mansion were not just programs, but adventures that fueled the imagination of millions. But the C64 wasn't only about gaming. It connected people, quite literally, through the Commodore modem. This marvel of technology transformed the C64 into a portal to the outside world. With the advent of Quantum Link, later known as America Online, the C64 became a gateway to an online community, a precursor to the social networks we know today. Imagine, in the heart of the 1980s, connecting to the Quantum Link service with your C64, the screen flickering to life, and suddenly, you are part of an online world. Chatting, gaming, sharing, all on a machine that could fit under your TV. It was a revolution, a glimpse into the future, and the C64 was at the forefront. Yet, as the 80s turned into the 90s, the landscape changed. More advanced systems emerged, but the C64's legacy endured. Its influence echoes through the corridors of the digital age, reminding us of the days when home computing was a thrilling frontier. The C64 has had a rebirth as of late, with its minis, maxis, and even appearing in films such as John Wick. Today, we're going to learn how to play our favorite C64 games using LaunchBox and RetroArch. Stay a while? Stay forever? Let's go. So before we begin, let's talk about the different file types you're going to encounter in emulating the Commodore 64. We're going to run through a few of the more popular file types. Now, these file types are based on the media that they represent, and each file type will offer you a different experience while emulating. First, you have the D64 image files. Now, these image files are from the single-sided, single-density 5 1/4 inch floppy disks, usually ripped from a 1541 disk drive. The next disk images you're going to encounter in the wild are the D71 and D81 disk images. These two file types introduce larger capacity disks to the Commodore 64. The D71 files are based off a 1571 disk drive. The 1571, utilizing a two-headed design, was able to read double-sided, double-density disks without flipping the disk over. Probably the least common file type you will encounter while emulating the Commodore 64. While not as uncommon as the D71 files, D81 files derives its name from the 1581 disk drive. Released in 1987, the Commodore 1581 is a 3.5-inch double-sided double-density floppy disk drive. Now, for comparison's sake, the 1541 disks were only 170 kilobytes. 1571, you double that. But the 1581 disk drive was able to store 800 kilobytes on a single 3.5-inch floppy. Amazing. Next up, the T64 file types. T64 is just an image of an audio data cassette tape. Yes, back in the day, we stored data on audio cassette tapes, read by a Commodore data set player. A very normal thing back then. There was no set storage capacity for a tape, since it would just use as much tape as it needed to use. With an increased size on a tape, and more tape it needed to read, increased loading times. It wouldn't be uncommon for you to load a cassette tape that would take 20 minutes to load. Because of these load times, this is not the most ideal file you want to look for. The most ideal files are the CRT files. Now, these are images of cartridges. Yes, the Commodore 64 had a cartridge port right there in the back. These are the images you want. There's instant loading. There is no blue screen load star, *8, 1, run. These files load instantly. You want to play a game now? Load the cartridge, you're playing the game. Now, there's been a concerted effort throughout the years to combine all the discs and tapes into a cartridge format. There's the One Load 64, there's the Ultimate Cartridge Collection, there's a bunch of them. Take a look at them. They'll help you a lot. There's also software that will allow you to create your own cartridges based on your D64 or your T64 images. But that's a video for another day, or maybe another channel. So first step is create a folder anywhere on your computer. Name it Commodore 64. Remember, if you name your folders correctly, it makes it that much easier for LaunchBox to know what you're importing. Inside of my Commodore 64 folder, I have a couple of different file types that we can play with. I have Nightmare on Elm Street, which is a multi-disk zip file. Inside of that zip file, there are three disk images, or D64 files. I have Murder in the Mississippi, which is a D64 native game. I have Miner 2049er, which is a CRT game. This game was originally released on cartridges. Not all Commodore 64 games were released on both cartridge and disk. We have a summer game, EasyFlash Cart. Now, this is a CRT that was made of the disk images. And then finally, we have Hardball, which is a tape image, or a T64. I have my fresh install of LaunchBox. Now we're going to head up to Tools, Import. We're going to import those ROM files. Next, we're going to add our folder, which is Commodore 64. Select Folder. LaunchBox knows it's a Commodore 64 because we named it appropriately. We're going to automatically install and configure RetroArch. You may already have RetroArch installed. Again, this is a fresh install. We're going to leave the ROM files where they are. I'm going to check all. If you have Emu Movies, set it up here. I'm going to download the bezels. I'm not sure if the Bezel Project has Commodore 64 bezels. We'll download them anyway. These are the files I'm going to import. Finish. LaunchBox is going to do its thing. It's going to import, grab the images, and here we are. Now that we have our games installed, let's take a look at how RetroArch is handling the Commodore 64 games. And we do have to make one slight change. We have to tell LaunchBox not to extract the zip files. We're going to head to Tools, Manage, Emulators. We're going to click RetroArch. We're going to click Associated Platforms. We're going to select the Commodore 64, which is using the Vice Libretto Core. We're going to uncheck Extract ROMs. We're going to leave Use M3U Playlist unchecked. Since our multi-disk images are tucked inside of a zip file, those files are automatically available to us when we go to the Disk Control menu to swap disks. First game we'll try, let's try Hardball. Now this is a tape image, so you can actually see the load and press play on tape screen. A lot of the Commodore games have intros and trainers. We'll just skip that. You're going to be asked to press Run Stop. What is Run Stop? We don't have that on current keyboards. So what Vice does, if you hit your select key, it actually brings up an on-screen keyboard. We're going to move over to Run Stop, and we're going to click the button. And there's Run Stop. A lot of the Commodore games have these psychedelic patterns that run across the screen. That's there for a reason, so you know the game is actually still loading. If you just had a black screen for minutes and minutes at a time, kind of think it's dead. Here's Hardball by Alkalade. Alkalade made some great games for the Commodore 64. Now Hardball got a nice little plug in Rob Reiner's movie, The Princess Bride. If you remember when Fred Savage is homesick from school, right before his grandfather comes over the tell him the story of the Princess Bride. Fred Savage is playing a baseball game on his computer. If you take a quick look, that is Hardball. Take another quick look, you see the 1541 disk drive next to his TV. Take another look, and there's a Commodore 64C or possibly a Commodore 128 right there. I digress. Back to Hardball. So Hardball is telling us press spacebar to play ball. So if we hit the spacebar now, we're just going to send a RetroArch command of fast forward to the emulator, which we're going to use later, but we'll get to that. So in order for the emulator to accept your keystrokes as a Commodore keystroke, you have to enable game focus. To enable game focus, you simply hit the scroll lock key on your keyboard. Now, when you hit the spacebar key, it's as if you're sitting in front of a Commodore keyboard hitting the spacebar. Still loads pretty quick. It's not a very large file. It's a fun game. One of the classics. Of course, the Hardball series would continue on to various other platforms, including the Sega Genesis, Sony PlayStation, PC. Some good games in that group. All right, let's move on. Let's try Miner 2049er. Now, this is a cartridge game. And you can see how quick it loads almost instantly. This is a weird game. This is kind of like Q-Bert, Pac-Man, Donkey Kong all mixed up. You have to kind of run on these little girders and they fill in. Don't get touched by these globby guys. And then you get the little power-ups like Pac-Man and then they turn into smiley faces and then you could just kill them. Again, this is another classic Commodore 64 game. I remember having this on cartridge. We played constantly. This and Load Runner. Another one to add to your collection. Again, a cartridge-based game. Loads instantly. Let's move on. Let's try a disc-based game, and it's Murder on a Mississippi. Very much a Agatha Christie-type game. You got to solve a murder on the Mississippi River in a paddle boat. This is a disc game. There is a little bit of disc loading. So now if we have game focus off and we hit our space bar, you see the top right, you got the double arrows, allows you to fast forward. We're going to hit the space bar again to shut off to fast forwarding. We're going to start from the beginning. Now, some people like to disable true drive emulation in the settings of Vice. I like to leave it. Some of the games don't work without true drive emulation. Just utilize that space bar to fast forward to loading screens if you have to. This game, you play a detective and his little partner, very much a Sherlock Holmes and Watson's kind of situation. Kind of almost like a Lucasfilm's Maniac Mansion, Zach McCracken type of game. Point and click. If I remember correctly, you go around a corner. And you go to room 4. And this is where you find a dead body. And then you got to question people, solve the murder. Check the evidence. Pretty cool game. Takes a little while to play. A lot of loading time in this game. So utilize that space bar. Let's move on to another game. Let's skip over Nightmare on Elm Street because that is a multi-disc game and we'll end with that. Let's hit Summer Games. Now, Summer Games was originally a disc game, but this was converted to a CRT using EasyFlash. There may come a time when you press a joystick button or you move your controller and it just doesn't move. And you go crazy thinking that your joystick is broke, but that's not the case. So the Commodore 64 was equipped with 2 joystick ports, or as they call them, control ports. Now, what was odd for some reason is some developers used Control Port 2 for Player 1, and some developers used Control Port 1 for Player 1. So what we have to do to change this is in Vice, when you hit your select button and it brings up that on-screen keyboard, you have a Joy P button. If you hit that Joy P button, it will switch between Joystick 1 and Joystick 2, so you don't have to fumble around changing your joystick inside of RetroArch. And here's Summer Games, another great series. You had Summer Games, Summer Games 2, Winter Games, World Games, California Games. I think that was it. Again, these are all staples of the Commodore era. Compete in all events. So we're going to enter our name. So in order to use a keyboard, we're going to hit scroll lock to turn game focus on. I can now type. Let's pick the good old US of A. Yes. First event is pole vaulting. Let's see if I remember this. You have to set your grip. And I believe right by that middle line there, you pull down. No, push up. And then button, and we're over. That's Summer Games. A bunch of different Olympic-style events. Multiple players. A lot of fun. Check it out. Again, a Commodore staple. Let's move on to our multi-disc game. Nightmare on Elm Street. Now, as you saw earlier, this is a zip file with 3 discs inside of it. So we're going to load that up. If you notice, Vice emulates the sound of the 1541 disk drive. This was our white noise in the 80s. One thing I remember from this game is that it played the Nightmare on Elm Street theme throughout the intro. Let's hit select and change to Joy P since my button's not working. Get to pick your character. Of course, we'll pick Nancy. So we have to play through the first level before we're prompted to insert disc 2. So let's do that. First level is a maze. You have to find Freddy's house without being attacked by Freddy. Freddy touches you. He removes part of your soul. Freddy's house is a brown house with all the lights on. It's random where it appears, so we just have to scroll through it. Oh, there's Freddy. Until we find it. Actually, there it is. That may have been the quickest I've ever found Freddy's house. Lucky for you. Okay, insert side two. Press a key. So we're going to hit F1 in RetroArch to open up the quick menu. Go down to disk control. We're going to eject the disk. We're going to hit current disk index. Now these are the disks that are inside of that zip file. We're going to pick the second disk. We're going to insert that disk. Close virtual disk tray. We're going to hit the button. And now we're playing side two or disk two of Nightmare on Elm Street. And that's all you really need to know about the Commodore 64 using LaunchBox, RetroArch, and Device Core. Sure, there's other advanced features you can mess with, but this will get you going pretty quickly. The Commodore 64 will always hold a special place in my heart. This was really my first console slash computer. I remember spending many hours into the early morning on BBSs downloading games. The Commodore 64 was released in the 80s, lived until the early 90s, during a time when we had the Sega Master System, Atari 800, NES, Sega Genesis. It ran its course. There are tens of thousands of games, often very simple, but very, very playable. It's not always about the graphics, it's about the gameplay. As always, questions, comments, leave them down below. This is RetroPython for LaunchBox. Till next time. Happy gaming.